Part 13.
Let's go. It's part 13, guys. Oh, yeah. There goes my Discord. Let's go. Wait up. What am I doing? It's not even October.
Bruh.
Right, let's get to the episode. It's been a while since someone suggested this. Gosh, I wish I had more time to do these videos. But yeah, now that more people are getting into HyperPad and you know, people want to learn how to make their own platformer games. This is for beginners who are still learning about HyperPad, but for the experienced, this video is just going to be a review for you. Don't worry, I'll make an advanced tutorial for you guys too, if time permits. Hopefully soon. Now, I am aware that people want to go crazy with the first projects. For starters, I recommend to start small. I see many people trying to do things that they don't know how to do. They search up tutorials and then complain that there aren't tutorials for them. And then they just stop using HyperPad, and that sucks. If you want to do something big, you want to work your way up. Learn the basics, read the documentation if you have to, and the best thing that you can do is experiment and have fun. You learn through trial and error, just like in real life. Things might not go the way you want, and that's completely normal. Keep trying and don't give up. Anyways, let's get started! It's really easy to make a platformer in HyperPad. No, seriously, let me show you. I know everyone's going to have their own specific idea in mind, but I'm just going to make a generic platformer that everyone could base off of. Once you are comfortable with it, you can start to add whatever you desire to it. I am going to start fresh with a new project. You have your scene here. You can click on this toolbox icon to see your assets. Assets are graphics, sounds, fonts, and all the other things that you can use in your project. If you want to, you can even import your own assets. For example, if you wanted to import an image, you can click on Import, Graphics, and you can pick from any of these locations to import your image. If I had some images in the camera roll that I wanted to import, I can click on Camera Roll and select the images that I want to import. But for this video, I will use a shop to get free assets. Wait, is this even a shop? I don't even know what it's called. But everything is free!
Say what?
You expect HyperPad to sell assets to you? This is free! This is HyperPad. Alright, after you got your assets, you can click on it to get it into this asset bar. You can drag your asset in and HyperPad will place it in the scene for you. What I have created is a graphic object. Now, there are some other object types with their own unique properties, but I won't get into that right now. All object types act almost identical, with one exception being the ad banners. Yeah, you can put advertisements in your games and earn money from it. That's HyperPad right there. What? You didn't know? Oh my god, I swear nobody knows about this. And yes, I will make a tutorial on that at some point. I don't know when, just remind me, okay? Alright, RX, no more sidetracks, no more sidetracks. You have your object. It's a graphic object. Objects have different physics modes. I already made a tutorial video explaining the three physics modes. It's literally one of the most important things that you need to know, so go watch it if you haven't. So, the three physics modes: wall, physics, and scenery. I'm not reading all of this, I'm sorry. I know I wrote this script, I'm just being so extra, oh my god. So, knowing all the physical properties, I set up the floor, which are wall objects. The player, which is a physics object, and some decorations scattered here and there, which are scenery objects. Now, this is literally all I have. I haven't added any behaviors to this. And of course, everyone's scenes are going to look a lot different than mine, so it just doesn't have to look like this. Just put your scene however you like it, okay? Now, let's test our project. Uh-oh. Bob, no! Wait, what? There's something down there? How the it was a void. Wait, if it even was a void, at what point does a player die? And why do we die if we fall through a hole and not through a pipe? Moving on. If your player is falling through the ground, then that might mean that the player or the ground are passable. Now, if you look at these objects, we can see this passable toggle enabled. Now, when an object is passable, all objects can pass through it, like a ghost. Turns out that Bob is a ghost. Who would've known?
Ooh, spooky!
I don't know, man. This Halloween spirit inside me is going crazy right now, and it's not even near Halloween. So, I made sure that the wall objects and the player are not passable. That way, Bob doesn't fall through the ground. If we test it again, we see that Bob is no longer clipping through the floor.
Yay!
If for some reason that didn't help, your player is still acting weird or your player is still falling through the ground, you can enable the setting in the pause or debug menu, which allows you to see collision hitboxes in your scene. In my scene, everything looks fine. But then again, someone else is going to have a completely different setup than mine, and that's understandable. So, what if you had hitboxes that didn't look right? Go back into the editor, select the object that you want to change the hitbox for, and press this icon. This allows you to modify physical collisions of any object. Once you have fixed the collision hitboxes, you're good to go. Press the checkmark button to save it. Now, at this point, I pretty much addressed all the issues that you can run into while making a platformer game. So, let's have fun. Now, let's make our player movable. So, going to the player objects, we are going to be controlling our player with a joystick and a jump button. So, let's use these behaviors. Joystick controlled and jump with button. Two behaviors and we've already got a working prototype. Whoa! Testing our project, Bob is moving pretty good. If Bob is too fast, too slow, or not jumping high enough, you can change those properties and the behaviors we just put in. You can also change a bunch of other things. If you press this globe icon, it will take you to the global settings. These global settings will affect your entire project. You can change the gravity, air resistance, and there's also other things like analytics. There's a lot that you can do with hyperPad, and I recommend just experimenting with them and seeing what you can do. I won't go over all the features in hyperPad in this video because that's outside the scope of this video. All we want to do is just make a little platformer game. Now, if you click on this screen icon, it will give you full control of your screen. You can change the background and the initial screen position in your scene. I'm going to make the screen follow the player using the screen follow behavior. Of course, you can also use the smooth screen follow, which I have shown in this video. But that's optional like everything else I do in this project. Now that we have created everything that we need for a platformer game, we can do anything we want. So let's spice it up with some stuff. Okay, here are some tips for making your platformer. I see a lot of people do this and it makes the game feel unpolished. People usually have the screen zoomed into the character so much that you barely get to see the entire scene, which makes it unpractical for gameplay. So, I recommend making the screen cover a larger area where the player doesn't take too much of the screen. As long as you can clearly see your player, you should be fine. In some platformer games that I've played, the player's hitbox is usually too big, so I recommend fitting in the collision hitbox to the sprite. It's actually better if you have the hitbox smaller than the sprite than larger. That way, players feel that the game is fair. Popular video games actually intentionally do this. Add music and sounds. If there's anything that some games are missing, it's music and sound effects. It's pretty easy to add those to your game too. Grab a play sound or play music behavior, whichever one you need, then select it and select whatever sound you want to use. Done! From there, you can just adjust the volume and other parameters. Alright, let's continue with our platformer project. You can check out the other HyperPad 101 tutorials for things you want to implement in your project. For this example project, I will add collectibles, particles, and lighting. If you want to learn how to add these aspects into your project, check them out in our YouTube channel. So, I'll be right back when I add all of those things.
guys might have seen it already, but I've added walking and jumping animations to my player. You can add animations by clicking on the behavior and clicking on an animation to the left to add animations. Same goes with the jump with button behavior. If you wanted to add your own animation with your own sprites, you can import each frame separately. As you can see, I've actually added spikes to my scene that teleport the player back to the starting point. All of these spikes have the obstacle tag, so when Bob touches them, it will move him back to the starting point. Oh, and one more thing. I added this behavior called passable platform. It makes the object be able to be passable from the bottom, but not from the top. That means Bob can jump through them from the bottom.
Okay, I went crazy with this one, I'll be honest. Guess how long this took? Oh no, I timed myself! Look at this. What other app allows you to make games this fast? On your iPad? Tell me! I want to know what rinky-dinky apps you haters be using to make your games. Yes, I admit it, I did a lot of things off camera, but trust me, I didn't do anything new other than those tutorials I listed earlier. Alright, so we have our collectibles, some lighting, and some atmospheric particles. What's next? From here, you can add anything you want, but I'm going to end it off with a flag at the end, where you complete the level. Okay. Now, here's the confusing thing. I want the player to go to the flag and touch it to complete the level. But I'm going to make the flag passable so the player can go through it. However, this doesn't mean that the player cannot touch it.
Huh?
That rule only applies to scenery objects because they don't have collision. The player can still collide with wall objects. Like farts. You can walk through them and not physically feel anything, but you can definitely feel the effects from it. If you watched this hyperPad 101 tutorial, this shouldn't be new to you. This is important because we want to detect when the player reaches the end. So in that flag, we use a collided behavior. And under the collide behavior, we can put anything we want to trigger when the player touches the flag. Let's say I play a sound effect and play a particle effect. Then after a bit, there's going to be a pop-up that says you've beaten the level. And that's all! You can do anything you want afterwards, but I'm keeping it simple. I'm finished with this little platformer game that I made, so here is some gameplay. Enjoy! I hope you enjoyed this little tutorial. Hopefully you learned some new things. I know I glanced over a lot of things and I know this is a long tutorial, but I want to encourage creativity. If you want to make your own game, you're going to need to explore some things for yourself. Play with the behaviors, learn what they do, and most importantly, have fun. And I will see you next time. I'm not the only one.